our second public meeting. I'd like to start off with any members of the press, please identify yourselves.
Hi, I'm with Connor, I'm Connor Finley with northendwaterfront.com.
Hello, I'm Noah, we're here with you.
Thanks. Any elected officials?
Patrick Lyons from Representative Aaron Michael's office.
Lori Lanza, Mayor Walsh, Dallas.
Great. So like I said, this is North Square, this is our second public meeting. We had our first one last year, end of November. I'm here today with our design consultant, Mrs. Grant Collins, landscape architect, Joel Grass, who's the civil engineer, to prepare you. So exciting project, we're gonna do a complete redesign and construction of North Square. Last public meeting, we had a lot of the same folks here, thanks for coming, we got a lot of good information from you. So I think that kind of shaped what we're showing you today. Since the last time we were here, Parks Department has caught up, they're doing the regular year park, which is directly abutting ours. They are also doing a construction, they have some exciting things they showed you earlier this summer. With that, I'm gonna head up to Grant Collins, and we'll go to the presentation. Make a little bit of background information, explain some concepts, and we'll open up questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Governor. As Joe said, we were here the end of last November, really with outlining the things that we want to take into consideration from what we saw out there in North Square, but also to hear input that gave us guidance on the development of concepts. And just to recap some of the things that we talked about there, and looking at some of the purposes and opportunities for the design. First off, recognizing that North Square is one of the oldest occupied neighborhoods in Boston, that is a significant place of history. It provides an open space that currently accommodates multiple uses and should as part of the redesign as well. Should be improving accessibility and safety for pedestrians and all accessibility for all users. Account for the deliveries and vehicular circulation that's important to the main businesses and restaurants that are around the area. And to coordinate our improvements with Rachel Revere Park improvements that is just to the right of that photograph in the slides up now. Some of the existing conditions, again, to recap that we took into account. We did study the traffic circulation through the square. You can see the railing guide can help us determine what we need to be aware of as it relates to development concepts. Pedestrian circulation is a significant element of the square. You have the Paul Revere House, you have the Freedom Trail, we did a pedestrian count just about a year ago, sunny Saturday, and there were about 6,500 pedestrians that came through the square between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. So that's a pretty significant number, and I'm sure that I'm not telling anybody that's familiar with the square anything that's new to them, that pedestrians certainly play a significant role in the activities in the square. Deliveries and functions, I've mentioned that before. We've got the restaurant deliveries, we've got St. John's School, which is where we are today. There's two buses that drop off, and there's a parent drop off as well. The church, St. Mark Church, which is just across the street, has funeral masses. All those things would need to be accounted for in the design that we were looking at. Parking is parking on the west leg of North Square, from the Paul Revere House. That's hourly parking. And there's resident parking in other locations around the square. Utilities, what's underground in the square is relatively significant. It doesn't seem like it's a big deal, but anything that we put above ground will probably have foundations or some sort of basis below ground that we have to account for as well. And so that's a pretty significant element that we need to be paying attention to. Areaways, generally those are those spaces from buildings that go out from foundations of the buildings under the sidewalk. We've been to almost all of the buildings and we've documented the areaways. It's a constraint, not a huge constraint, but something that we need to pay close attention to. And then the historic element, as I said, this is the Freedom Trail, and a number of historic buildings, the Paul Revere House, the Sacred Heart Church, the Mariners Home. I mean, these are elements that, not just from a historic standpoint, play a significant part of the square, but architecturally, all of the buildings really speak to defining the character of the square itself. So at the last meeting, there were a number of comments, and I'd like to go through them, be able to set the stage for how we formulated the concept. We wanted to make sure the comments at the square, the history of the square, and the surrounding buildings should be reflected in the design. The square is not very pedestrian friendly, we heard that a lot. We heard concern about mixing vehicles and pedestrians, making sure that that was something that we paid attention to. Process needs to merge the historic property needs with the residents, so making sure that not only the business owners and people who are coming to visit the historic sites are accounted for, but the residents as well. The design must be careful not to impact the uses of businesses that are there, because the deliveries that I've mentioned, there's a lot of people that come through the square in the evenings for the restaurant business. Concerns about students and others hanging out, I think this is something that was both with North Square and Rachel to be a part. And that was a concern. Making sure that a water feature was considered as part of the design was a concern as well. I think we heard from a lot of people that the cobblestones were an important aesthetic for the square that needs to be accounted for. Maritime chain was talked a lot about as an important element of the square. It helps to keep cars out of the center of the square. And it was said that there was a chain that was on a whole iron side. We've actually done a little research. It wasn't actually on a whole iron side, but it did come out of the Charlestown Boatyard where a whole iron side is. But still, regardless, it's an important cultural feature that I think people have come to really run accustomed to in the square. The square should be for pedestrians first and vehicles second. I think we heard that a lot in the last meeting. The square should include amenities for sitting and resting. I know that there's some seats out there today that are used a lot by the people who visit the square in the area. And then Rachel Revere Park, we need to coordinate what we're doing in a collaborative way with Rachel Revere and North Square so that at the end of the day, those two people, those parks, though they have individual characteristics, at least have a function to them, to each of them that work together. So this is Rachel Revere Park. We've had a number of meetings. Joe mentioned the last meeting that was here for Rachel Revere about a month and a half ago, where they went through four concepts. We're going to go through three concepts for North Square. As we move forward and get in input from tonight and continue the design process, we will be continuing to collaborate with the folks on the Rachel Revere Square design as well. So the existing conditions, this is what you have today. What we've done in looking at all the elements that I've been reviewing as we lead up to this slide, it's come through our, I guess, realization that if you're going to maintain the cobbles, maintain a certain degree of the chain, and you're looking at improving pedestrian-friendly characteristics, you need to figure out a way to have accessibility for all incorporated into the square. And you want to let the buildings and the surroundings really become a significant part of what the character of the square is. The concepts that we're going to present really are very similar. There's more subtleties in them, and I'll point those subtleties out as I go through the concepts. But they really start to look a lot alike. It really is taking the square as it is today and really just trying to spruce it up and make improvements in accessibility in a way that we can maintain and improve pedestrian circulation, can maintain vehicular circulation from a delivery standpoint, and keep a certain element of familiarity, if you will, with how the square looks today to what is being proposed. So in concept one, basically what we're looking at, the big change that both concepts have is taking this leg across the square and raising it up to the pedestrian level, to the sidewalk level. So this entire area would be one level. This would be a roadway defined by curb lines on either side in a typical fashion. And then you have a sidewalk on the other side that goes in front of Rachel Revere, Fall Revere House and Marin House. So under this concept, where we currently have brick sidewalks, we're maintaining brick sidewalks, but we're trying to increase the size of the square, the plaza, the gathering area. We're utilizing the chain, which is here, to be able to, in a similar way, define that pedestrian zone that encloses on the square. You can see where the chain currently is located. That's the current location. But we're providing breaks in the chain. So those metal stanchions in the chain, we're utilizing, but we're basically utilizing it in a different manner. We're going to set it up so that we can have free flow from all elements or all sides of the triangular shape in the center that gets you into the center and allows you without the barrier of chain. In this particular concept of new clay brick, resetting the existing cobbles through here, with the exception of these crosswalks in this intersection, which is a raised intersection, so the intersection is up level with the sidewalk area to help improve ADA accessibility. Those would all be new granite, as would be this area, and this would be new granite pavers as well, with a slight differentiation from the new granite pavers in the center in both sides, the coloring and maybe the texturing, to give the ability for that to be perceived still as a roadway, but really primarily as a pedestrian zone. We're expanding the sidewalk, proposing to expand the sidewalk as a dotted line right here. That is the current curb line, so we're pushing that out, making that a little bigger. And we're expanding the sidewalk right down from the grand slab in front of the Mariner House. So we're getting a little more sidewalk space in front of the Paul Revere House, over what's there today. And then in this zone, we're expanding the sidewalk. This is the dash line over the existing curb line, expanding that out a little bit further as well. In the square itself, the triangle itself, we've got two trees within planting areas. We've got sort of a planting area here with sort of concrete or some sort of material transition, maybe some granite wall that helps to define the triangle. That could be a flush granite, could be a raised granite, looking for your input on what that might be the best way to do that. But having two trees within this zone right here, preserving the tree that's existing down there by Rachel Revere. What we're looking at to try to help the tree survive, and there's been many trees have been planted over the years, is to increase the size of the area that the board can get in. It's about 16 square feet per tree that's out there today, and we're increasing it to almost 40 square feet. And the other thing that we're going to be looking at is providing a soil material underneath that the root zone can actually grow into and be able to thrive in, as opposed to what's probably there today. This is a view of the concept, sort of a somewhat pseudo-pedestrian eye view. And you can see this is, again, the existing cobbles reset. New granite that would be placed in where the crosswalks are. And new granite within the pavers within the actual triangle part of the square. And new granite pavers here. Looking at ornamental lights similar to what's out there today. And what you'll notice is this is all flush, so this is, there's no grade change, or I should say there's no curb line coming from this side of the square all the way across this extension of the roadway here into the triangle shape. The only curb line that one would encounter would be here on the western side of the square. And so what we're doing is closing maybe a couple of bollards to prevent cars from getting up within the sidewalk zone or the brick area in places that they shouldn't be. Even though this whole area is meant to be easily accessible by pedestrians, it is also meant to still provide circulation to be able to go down this way, much like it does today. But we're trying to get a hierarchy to the pedestrians on that leg. And we were able, looking at the traffic study, realize that, you know, that doing something like this is probably based on traffic and based on input that we've got from folks at the engineering and traffic department is something that we can consider. Concept number two has a lot of similarities. I think the biggest differences is looking at maintaining the center island, the flowers that the Parks Department places and maintains, and getting a more defined area of reset cobbles at this area. So this would be our cobbles that would be reset here, and then we have, this is a pedestrian accessible zone there and over here as well. So the difference between this concept and the other concept is the amount of existing granite that gets reused, and the planter in the center and the other elements are very, very similar. So you can see we've got the crosswalk here. Basically, the existing granite cobbles reset out there would not be an acceptable ADA compliant crosswalk because of the differentiation of, say, the edges up to the top of the granite is sort of rounded. So they're very difficult. They wouldn't be considered ADA accessible. So in using them on this leg, we need to provide a crosswalk zone to get from one side, this side over here, to this side and across the street, whereas in the other concept, where the pavers are new pavers, we don't have that issue. This concept reuses the lion's share of the granite cobbles that are out there today. So what you can see is these lighter gray areas. These are where the new cobbles, the new ramp will be placed for ADA accessibility. And then we have the rest of the existing ramp cobbles reset. Now, when I say reset, they'll be very different from how they're looking today, where they've started to push apart from each other. These be reset tight against each other. So the gaps that we see would be eliminated. The depressions that we see out there would be eliminated. And they'd be reset in a manner that it would be a relatively continuous surface, but as I said, it wouldn't necessarily be a surface that would be considered ADA accessible. So that's why you see this new brand that we have in these locations that helps to provide for the ADA accessibility in and around the site. So what we're trying to do is strike a balance between what we heard at the last meeting as far as maintaining a certain look and feel of the cobble and how important that is to the aesthetic of the square, but providing ADA accessibility that really is a challenge that's out there today. Maintains the chain, uses it in a different manner. Each of the options have a slightly different layout to the chain. So in this particular option, with the little metal stanchions, we have more than what's out there today. So we'd be possibly fabricating them or somehow looking at the Charlestown Boulevard to see if there's a way that they're more available. But trying to maintain that look and feel of the chain and the definition of the square. And again, the only place that we'll have curb lines will be on this leg of the roadway, and then this becomes flush. These crosswalks are sort of the typical crosswalks. You cross set down a ramp on the crosswalk and up the sidewalk. The other thing to point out is in front of the Merriman House, on all three options, is the granite slabs that are there today are going to remain there today. We're not proposing to change them. We're going to maintain them and tie our sidewalks into them so that some of those subtle characteristics, differences that are out there today are things that we're incorporating or maintaining in the design. So that is a quick overview. I think the intent is to hear from you, get your comments on this to help guide the design. I think it's important to say that while we presented three options, we could stick, it could be the feeling of the group that there's a singular option that is important and it's great that it should move forward. Or to a certain degree, we can mix and match elements. If there's some things that you like as opposed to others, that's something that we'd be entertaining as well. So with that, I'll go to this gentleman right in the back.
I'm very happy that you kept the bollards in. I'm very happy you kept the bollards in the chain because it was me that told you where they came from. Quite possibly we can get some more from them, I don't know. But I like the number three proposal only because I think if we don't keep the cobblestones on both sides, it sort of throws off the square itself. I think we should go with three with the cobblestones on both sides of the park.
Two heavy cobblestones on both sides of the other as well.
Yeah. Well, either way.
I don't know if you're here,
but I'll go here. I just have a clarifying question. On all three of them, is the right side of the square raised up to the sidewalk level?
On all three of them, yes. Right.
Just a suggestion. Question dealing with cobblestones. Have you been to New Bedford by any chance? They have dealt beautifully with cobblestones in the New Bedford historic area, in the area of the Wellington City. You've been done very successfully. And you are from Rhode Island.
I am.
So it's easy to get to New Bedford.
I've been to New Bedford many times. Okay.
So I guess
I've seen the one area that you're talking about. Yeah, and just to be clear, I think even under the new brand, the intent would be that could be smaller pieces or larger pieces. I think the ADA accessibility folks would like those pieces to be larger because of less gaps, and that, you know, with time, that's where the issues of settlement and differentiation between the surfaces come in. So larger pavers are more friendly in the long run to providing ADA accessibility. But I think the size and the shape of those are certainly things that we're open to hear more about.
When the project starts, is Boston Water and Sewer, or Boston Sewer going to be in? Are we picking up again?
They're going to be in front of us, yes.
Second question, once it's built, does the city have any plans to put vendors on the street like they do in a regular place they're building now?
vendors on the street?
I'm sure we can consider it something.
It's not a place to put vendors.
Sir? First of all, I want to say the three designs, to my mind, are much more common than the preliminary design. So I want to give you guys credit for putting together some good designs. The thing that I want to ask you about concept number three is that you mentioned that you may need to, you will need, as designated there, to fabricate some new chain. And I wanted to ask, well, you know, is that strictly necessary? Because with the elevated Moon Street portion, maybe you don't need as much chain between Moon Street and the Center Square as you do in the other areas. And building on that point, I wanted to ask if you guys have seriously considered making Moon Street, you know, going just the last 10 feet of where you've already gone, to say, really, this is not a vehicle street. You redesignate Sunport Street as one way going up in that map and taking a turn to the right. And you let Moon Street be just a pedestrian way. Because I think your traffic plans suggested you can do this, but there's not a whole lot goes down there, and maybe we can just go a little further.
I think from a project budget standpoint, that might be challenging under this project, but certainly if it's successful, if it's done as part of this project and it's successful, it could be a follow-up project. And we could look at
just clarify you're saying the whole map.
Well, I'm not saying to change anything in terms of the construction. What I'm saying is just Moon Street, in that particular area, being very interested to hear what other people say, but from North Street over to the elevated intersection with Sunport, why should that be a street at all? Why can't that just be part of the square and you have less baller need there than, although still sound for aesthetics. And you really sort of, say cars can go up there on a special needs basis if there's an event at the church. But you sort of make it so that the norm is that cars aren't going there.
We're certainly trying to discourage it. We have been clear with the transportation department to actually make it to a pedestrian.
Yeah, I think school definitely uses that from a drop-off standpoint.
I live on Moon Street. Please don't change that to go cars. Please.
We drive to the moment.
I'd like to
drive up there every day.
Well, I don't drive up there every day. No.
Well, I agree.
But I think if Sunport were reversed.
If Sunport, do you ever try to get a turn from Sunport?
Well, we did talk to the traffic department about reversing Sunport. I think it's one of the things that we're looking at is because of the way circulation works with the school, that would be problematic.
I get concerned when we're trying to mix pedestrians and cars, and people say, okay, we're going to elevate it, and it's going to be like cars are going to be discouraged. Cars and pedestrians and bikes, if you don't carefully control the intermix, can create horrible results.
Right, that's why we're elevating, so that the car knows when it comes into that zone, it's entering a different zone than what it was before, and it's the pedestrian have more of the priority, if you will. I think to a certain degree, because of the sheer amount of pedestrians that are in this area, and sort of, I would say, even with the current conditions of the areas being very hard of accessibility, they sort of permeate through the entire square. And so the square at the choke down, when you first enter in, down here, and really that message almost begins right there. And so I think that that's an important consideration. We're doing our best to try to get a higher priority to the pedestrians, but I don't think we're going to eliminate the cars in really any of the ways and be able to maintain some of the functions that exist out there today.
Fair enough.
Hi, my name is Bob Domenico. I'm from the Boston Transportation Department. And any sort of change that would be made to make a pedestrian way or change the direction of Sunport Street would require a petition with 75% of the people that are impacted by this general neighborhood to approve that. And so there is a process. So, I mean, if that's something you folks want to consider, that's up to you.
I just want to say you have to anticipate that the fire engines cannot come up Moon Street and make a turn. That has to be there for the fire engines to get down there.
Right, as well as public safety matters as well.
Right, and I'm not saying make it, put bollards up and make it so no vehicles can go. Make it so that the suggestion was that I'm hearing a lot of people maybe oppose this. The section suggestion was not make it be primarily, make it one of those things where you say vehicles can come up here.
like downtown crossing, vehicles go through it, you know, but it's not normally supposed to happen. What I want to do is discourage tourists from driving.
So, I'm really not in favor of closing off Connor Street, primarily because there are residents on that side, but my question was going to be, when you look at the, at North Square, on the right-hand side of North Square, will we be losing those resident parking spaces? And will we be losing the left-hand side of Moon Street's parking spaces?
I'm not aware that there's parking on that side. Over here, there's parking?
Yeah, I thought you said.
I don't think so.
Where is the residence versus the?
The resident parking is.
Go to.
But it's our resident parking here.
No.
Over here and over here. This is signed for no parking.
There's no resident.
Well, let's put it this way. It's signed for no parking. People park there today. If people should park there in the future, this design does not prohibit that. I guess that might be the right way of saying.
So I guess what I was going to ask then is if there's a funeral at Sacred Heart Church, they would have to get some kind of a permit to be able to park.
They don't get a permit today. They don't get a permit today. The way that it's currently, again, that's part of the way the design unfolded is that those uses, a lot of the existing uses, we didn't want to impact them. We wanted to make whatever improvements we could to pedestrian safety, circulation, and accessibility. And so if you look at any one of the designs in that area, there's the chain today. There's the chain under this proposal. There's the sidewalk today. There's what is defined as the sidewalk under this proposal. And it's all one level. It's not a grade change from the standpoint of the curb line. So we're really, there's some real subtle differences. So the way it functions today, cars will be less of a priority, but they won't be prohibited.
So will Moon Street lose? I know those are, there's parking spaces on Moon Street.
Up here, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Still be.
We're not touching that.
Fair
enough. I'm going to go here, and Sandra, I'll be here.
The cobblestones that are there right now, will they remain, or will they be double covered?
We're going to reset them, so we pull them up,
yeah. And
then they'd be reset. Probably put a concrete base underneath them, because it's
able to fit.
Well, the actual level that they're on, it probably would be subtly different. Certainly here, it would be different because they'll be raised up to the sidewalk level. And in the option number 3, in here, they'll be different because we're going to basically be trying to blend that grade in from this side over here to a higher level where they are currently lower, up to a higher level. So generally speaking, they'd be in the same general space, elevation-wise, but with some changes more so dramatically on that side. I'm going to bop over here, and then I'll catch you.
I wanted, perhaps, to try to assuage some of the neighborhood's concerns that what you guys, what they don't intend to close off Moon Street to make it inaccessible. What's going on right now is a lot of the functions that need sort of protection or exceptions from parking, like the funerals and weddings, the kids that spill out from recess from the school, they kind of naturally create these barriers at certain times during the day. And I think these guys recognize that and they want to try to preserve or protect that. So the idea is not to close off those streets, certainly. Number one, there is no resident parking in North Square. There's only the highly coveted after 6 p.m. parking along the Mariner's House that where anybody can park.
Right.
The rest of it, only commercial vehicles can enjoy because they're allowed to park in the parking zones while they're working in the place. So I'm kind of defending them. You know, on your bit, because believe me, I live in the middle of all this, and I agree that it would be tragic not to have access to those parking spaces. I wonder whether the chains, why I applaud the idea of protecting, I like concept one, I like the idea of you know, a gesture towards making the entire space accessible, towards being able to get from the north sidewalk and the east sidewalk to the middle area, so everybody, whether you're in a wheelchair or high heels, or you're older, whatever, can enjoy. I think that's a wonderful idea. Why have chains on the north and east sides at all? What purpose do they serve?
The north side, well, just for making sure we're all on the same page, just saying the north side here, why have chains there? And then why have chains here?
No. I love the idea of keeping chains there, if anything, double the chains there, because that is a corridor that is highly, I'm calling that the west side.
Okay.
All right. The east side, I'm calling the side on the first side.
Yeah.
So I'm saying, why have chains at all on the east side, and why have chains at all on the north side?
I would say the north side, probably for, call it sentimental reasons that are there today. The east side is definitely a functional element. If cars are coming up here, much like you have the lights with the bollard in between, we basically want the cars to realize this is the area that you can go in, and we don't want people, whether accidentally or on purpose, to drive into this area.
But you are, scheme one effectively, architecturally, creates a homogeneous space there, don't you think? Visually, that will read as like you can't just drive willy-nilly.
I agree that it would read that way, but how it would actually function for people who may not know, or people who may be taking advantage of the situation, I think we got to reinforce it. Now, does that mean that we leave it exactly the way it is, or maybe we look at making this a little more perforated, maybe not have as much chain, and have chain maybe either gone or just expansions? I could see that being a possibility.
Okay, I'm going to summarize my, so that other people can speak. I like concept one. I applaud the idea of a strong edge on the west side. I would completely close that off. If anything, remove the chains and double them on that side. And I question the idea of why have any barriers whatsoever, because what I've observed over the years is people have a tough time getting from the sidewalk to the middle of the square, wherever they are, to get into the middle of the square, from the church side or from the north side.
Okay.
Yeah, so on the east side, the continuous chain is a problem, because oftentimes after a mass, on a funeral or a wedding, people like to gather in that center area, in that triangular area, and they wind up having to step over the chain. Now that you're leveling the area, you're creating almost a plaza, but it's a plaza that's interrupted by a chain. Consequently, and the most logical place to use, one of the logical areas of buildings that would use that plaza is the church. They'll use it, as I said, after weddings, they'll use it in funerals, they'll use it in garden jobs. Consequently, to create a plaza in front of the church and separate and then break it up with a chain seems to defeat the purpose of that area, unless you really want to leave it as an enclosed area and not have people use it.
Well, right, we have it now with these two spaces, which that space is probably about, I don't know, I'm going to guess like 30 or 40 feet. But what I think I'm hearing is, you know, if we didn't have a chain on this side, that'd be fine. But what I'm saying is, I think from the design perspective and a safety perspective, if it's going to be used a lot, we need to do something there to help reinforce the fact that cars shouldn't be there. And I think not having something, though I agree that all the elements that we were talking about in the design will help lead people to the conclusion that it's not a place for automobiles, I think given the dire need for parking that takes place in the business atmosphere, time of the day, and in evenings here and weekends, it would quickly become something that could become a problem. So that's why I think having something there to help reinforce that this is not a place for cars would make a lot of sense.
But do you think that it has to be something that's as solid as a chain?
No. I think those stanchions that the chain is linked to, and maybe even just shorter legs. I mean, just have more stanchions than a short leg or no chain at all.
The stanchions actually would certainly cut off the area that allow passage through.
Right. So this would be an example of what it would look like. This is just a stanchion, so you have stanchion, stanchion, and this one only has a little length of chain, you know, three had a larger length of train. So what we're, you know, we wanted to be able to put that out so that we can evaluate a number of different options.
To add on to that idea, I would suggest that if you kept the concept of one but added a circular planter in the middle, that would also discourage people from helping themselves to parking in the middle.
So this concept one and concept two, the two major differences between them are the circle in the middle and this being reset cobbles. So if we were going to go basically with a mix, a mongrel, of say concept one, maintain the new cobbles on the new brand here and here, and then just put the planter in the center and use stanchions only through these legs and have the chain only on the what would be the west side, the barrier outside.
So in concept one, why would you remove the planter?
To provide a greater area of gathering space in the center.
So if you're going to use that, that center space is extremely valuable. I mean, if you could use to give it a multifunctional purpose, I mean, is there any way of building something into that for a concert? The school will often have an impromptu concert in the middle of the square.
One of the things that will is likely to be part of the project is some sort of public art. So what could happen is there could be something in the center of that planter that would be a foundation. Maybe there's an art in the center. It could also be a place that the would be have power for performance that may take place in the square. I mean, given the size of it, maybe it becomes smaller, or maybe it does become a different paving material that has the ability to have a source of power that can be used for performances.
But if it's placed, if there is something as obtrusive as that placed in the center of it, it seems to negate the use of that space. It almost seems that area should be left clean so that you can do things there.
What do people think about that?
Like a fountain would be nice there.
Yeah, I didn't really address the fountain. I think that just given the maintenance concerns, the fountain is likely to be off the table. It's just really a high maintenance element that would be problematic. So I just want to make sure from the planter versus no planter standpoint, where do people stand on that? The people who like planters, raise your hands. People who don't like would think it should be a wide open area. What are you doing? Do you want the planter? I think you voted twice.
I have something. I have something in between. I think the planter. You started with a couple trees because I think shading is a consideration that's important. And the two trees at the periphery, what ought to be central, would be the development of something major because you got to wait till 4 p.m. for the sun to desist to have any kind of habitable space over there. But if you took the planters instead and say, make this area, put some very healthy, large trees, that would provide shading in there that I think that would completely transform that space. And I agree with, I think it was Richard that said, the planter in the middle, it kind of, it segregates the entire space so that you have a bunch of smaller areas that are basically.
So I can see an option where these maybe pull down and become expanded. They help give definition. Part of the reason why we place them there is that they have they're a vertical element. They're going to have a very strong architectural characteristic to them. And one of the things that we recognize ourselves and was echoed in the last public meeting is that the buildings really help to define the visual character of the square. But I can see something where we wouldn't have the planter here, but we might pull these down, they get more centralized, able to be able to provide additional shade, and maybe the base of them become a little bit larger, so they're not in the center. And you have a larger contiguous space, but you still have the benefit of having these for maybe some underplantings that would be flowers.
So in areas congested as to not then where space is at a premium, to center that triangle with something that negates the use of that space seems to be a crime. You could put the thing off center put it, and you, if the idea is to give the square a central piece, something that's going to, you can put it at the very tip of the triangle.
Well, this could become a bigger zone, too. I mean, that doesn't have to be that size.
Exactly.
It can become larger.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But the space itself, it would almost seem to, I mean, it's practically saying it should be left plain.
So I'm going to try to catch some new people.
Do they do that now?
Well, let's put it this way, we're not prohibiting that for the place. I'm going to go here.
If you don't put something in the center, you get nothing. You just have a bunch of people standing in the front. That center piece is like, when you go into the square, it's beautiful. Even in the window, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
With the tree there. But if you don't have that, people go there and stand there and do what? Well, nothing. They're not looking at anything, they're not sitting anywhere.
Well, I think what they would do is
they
continued mobile tables and benches and things. I mean, that's a nice element that can be moved around to where they shade, and that helps them liven the square as well.
And it's so pretty. The city keeps it beautiful. People are always taking pictures of the drive, and it's the same story of what goes on in this pretty square.
Yeah.
But if you take it away, then there's nothing. If you put tables, it makes a mess. Nobody cleans up the mess. Benches are nice. Those are good for people to sit and hear a talk or whatever they want to do. The tables, I totally disagree with them because people leave their messes there. You know, they're laying on them at night. You have to come here at 12 o'clock at night, watch them lay and sit on the benches and do whatever else they're going to do. So the tables, I don't think they should be there. A bench is somebody wants to eat a sandwich or they want to take their trash away. There's no place that they ever put their trash in. The facility, the trash bucket is going to look terrible there. So maybe the centerpiece and the benches would be very nice, and it still would have that photographic look.
Well, I'm in favor of the planter or something green and, you know, seasonal in the center or somewhere in the square. Perhaps if that was raised so that the perimeter of it was provided seating, and maybe the same for some of the other corners in the square that would be raised to provide some seating, like they're talking about down in Kildare Air Square. But I'm all for having some color and some seasonal growth in the center.
And continue to go with some new folks.
What if instead of pulling the trees down, you push a planter back? In other words, the planter went up into the gap between the two trees so that you retain some of the space in the center but still have a focal green, and it could, instead of being circular, be an oval or something, because we've got rid of the chain up there, but we could, that might do both things.
Yes, I think what I'm hearing is we need to find a way under a scheme that looks somewhat similar to this, not talking about painters, what they are, and the chain, is to find a way to maintain a certain level of enhancement, but try to find a balance between that and the openness, so the contiguous space in the center that makes it a little more functional. So I think that would be one of our challenges. I'm going to go here and then back there.
Just a quick revision in terms of, I mean, if it was moved more toward the front corner and maybe shaped like the shape of the square, you know, rather than circular, if it was more triangular, again, you know, providing a raised surface for seating and then getting it out of the middle, so it could still have some color there and not negate the use of the other stage.
I'm also sorry.
Oh, I thought it was.
Sorry. No, it's good.
Just make
maybe the blue shirt, yes.
Okay. Let's talk about aesthetics. We're talking mostly functionality with a little bit of aesthetics. But as I look at the renderings and as I look at the bird's eye view, it looks bleached. It has a very white, hot sensation for me. Why? Why? Because it's granite and cobblestones. How about some brick? How about brick in the center? In the piazza itself, or something to take away the bleached feeling. But I'd like to hear from other people. Sandro? who's the esthetician?
I've done a lot of talking already.
I think, I mean, basically the reason why we haven't laid out those options the way it is that it became very clear that the cobble look was a preferred look. What we're trying to do is strike a balance between maintaining that look and feel, but providing the maximum amount of accessibility. And accessibility is not utilizing the, or relying on the existing cobbles, even though they're reset. So, you know, that was, and it was, I think, correct me if I'm wrong for the folks who were at the last meeting, I thought that it was pretty loud and clear that the brick, because we had that option had brick on the edges of that triangle, and it was, to my mind, it was loud and clear that that was not preferred.
They wanted to change the taste or not.
Right. I'm going to go with this.
Do you have a comment?
Yes.
And then I'll go there.
Yeah, the plan is so this. Nina mentioned about moving it, you know, having an oval one, and the lady there mentioned about putting it towards the front. Because on the greenway, you know, there's a lot of tables, you have those metal tables, the silver with matching chairs, and also that Marina Park, the seaport area. It's very nice, and the people do maintain it. They tap arrows and they keep it clean. So maybe dispersing that in that area.
So I'll go here, and then what I'm hoping to do is maybe move off the planters. We've got the chain, I think, sort of nailed down. I want to get a little clarity on the granite versus the new granite versus the cobble. So after that question, that's where I'd like to move to.
Okay, great. The question, I have one question and one comment. I'll do the comment first. We've had, you referenced the last meeting, and I think one of the issues that there was such ordered rejection last meeting was because there were a lot of people who have said, and they may be different than the people here tonight, that there is certain continuity that the neighborhood wants to the historical nature of the square. It's one of the most historical squares in the country, and you know, it's in the pictures in a lot of history books, and if you put something that looks totally different, it would sort of blow things up a bit. To that extent, you know, I think the consensus last time in that meeting seemed to be, you know, we want to make it sort of look like what we had done before, but work better and be better. That links into the planter, because I've heard some folks say, why don't we move the planter off the center planter? Why don't we have the whole square accessible? I just want to remind people, if we make the whole square a big gathering place, different than it is now, you will get the consequence of having that. You'll have meetup folks meet there, you'll have events, you'll have people try to schedule concerts there, and you will have, and you may even get a bike rack, you know, the hubway coming back and trying to put their bikes there, because it'll be a logical place to do that. So there will be consequences if you actually aren't thinking about the uses that you're opening up if you move things around. And I think the configuration, particularly number three, which is the most like the original, is a brilliant design, and all of them are very nice, but that's my favorite. The question that I have is on irrigation. You mentioned the trees, you mentioned a larger area, but I haven't heard anything about irrigation. Irrigation for the planters would be very important. We have a bunch of places in Christopher Columbus Park that circles with trees and flowers that are not irrigated, and they're a problem, particularly to Victor's point. This is a sun-drenched place. Without irrigation, I think we're cooked on a lot of the planting, so I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I think something we'll look into. I make no promises, but we're taking the comments and we'll be able to incorporate them as we can.
The idea that should not be a reserve, that should be a meetup place. We've spent plenty of time in Europe and places like the Strøget in Copenhagen, Piazza Navona in Rome, where they're natural gathering places. To take that space in the middle of the Notbend and take a place that's a natural gathering place and then try to turn it into some kind of an aesthetic reserve is ridiculous.
We'll move on to the planter comment. Because I think we've heard it was our challenge to come up with a concept. So and how do people generally feel about what we're talking about as far as the chain goes, where we make this side much more perforated, maybe just stanchions, really no chain on this side, chain only on this side? Is that something that people seem to feel comfortable with? Do you like the idea of having chain all the way around? So having a larger opening, but still maintaining the character of the chain in its current sort of layout.
You could do for a whole
But an opening, a post with a chain.
So maybe the wider, the gap, maybe the relationship of the openings is greater than the relationship of the chain. Which is kind of 50-50 on this particular option. How about on the materials? We have basically three different options of the use of the new brand. This one maximizes the existing cobbles reset, and then we have these bands of new brand that provide the ADA accessibility. We have this one, which is really just the center of the new brand with some bands, but probably you need one right here as well. And then we have this option, which has the larger area of new brand with the existing cobbles there.
One is easier to clean.
Can we text numbers?
I don't know if you can help. Or maybe something in between. But anyways, I think it sounds to me like there's a preference to maximize the amount of existing cobbles being reused in the design.
I have three things. One, what Victor said, it looks pretty with the concrete, very sterile looking. It's like a federal playground. It's like, you know, I think when it's like bleached like that, there's no character to it.
It wouldn't be concrete, it'd be a stone.
Stone, yeah.
I was just going to say, I mean, the way you can specify a granite that has a darker characteristic to it.
And also, would you consider putting a flagpole up there, being it's the Freedom Trail?
Then you have to light it to leave the flag up all night, and if not, you have to take it up and down.
Yeah, I mean, there are a number of locations along the Freedom Trail that have flag poles. I'm not sure that this one needs to be another location. Other comments?
And my last one was the chain, if it stays, is it the same chain or is it smaller version?
No, we're using the same chain. We clean it up, paint it pink, and put it back out there. No. Other questions?
The flagpole makes good sense because you're doing Rachel with their park. You can put a light there to shine on the flags. The flag can go 24 hours.
We're taking notes.
I mean, that's history.
This is.
We do have an American flag in this country. I don't know how long we're going to have it, but we do have it. For the colonial one.
Other questions or comments?
Well, I think Sandra made a comment, I think, about the easier to clean, probably, the non-cobblestone. I mean, I know the city does send out the sucking up machines and, you know, picks up the pieces occasionally, but it doesn't happen regularly.
So. Oh, I think it's a valid point, because the granite cobbles got that rounded top to them, so it's more difficult to clean them. Well, they're going to be reset close together, but if you were to pick one of those up and look at the sides, and then you think about how rough that side is against the roughness of another side, you will have a gap there. That's part of the reason why it's not considered an accessible, surface.
And all the confetti and all the cigarette butts are going to go
right. That, like I said, I think it's a valid point that something that is the newer granite will be easier to keep clean as opposed to the cobbles. The right material, right thickness, the right setting bed.
That's a lot of things to get right. We've seen a lot of granite crack in other parks. So.
Yeah, I mean, like a minimum 4-inch thick granite slab on a concrete base. It's
if we have three winners like the last one, it won't be successful.
There are places where it's been done successfully, and there are reasons why it's successful. Mm-hmm.
Is there the tip of the triangle is also planting in all the three schemes? Is there some consideration of how you would dispose of that or otherwise?
Well, I think, I mean, we've always thought that the planting areas under the trees and this planting would be an area that would be treated very much like how that center circle is treated, where there's the annual plantings that give it a little color and life. So that's generally what we've been thinking.
So that would be planted as well.
Yeah, that's all right there. Yeah.
Can we figure out what that box was? Remember, there was, was that a street light box? That's at the tip of the...
It looks like it's an old light box, yeah.
And that...
But I can't tell you with surety that's exactly what it is.
You know, I think Ford, Ford made some, made a very good point that I'm a history guy. And I was a history major in college, and there is, in fact, many photos of that square in a lot of history books. And I think it is very important that the consistency of the square, to some extent, remain, you know, especially the major sticking points. Like, you know, I love the planter in the middle. It's always been there. I mean, I played in Rachel Revere Park as a kid. The cobblestones are obviously extremely important. You know, we have the gas lamps. But I think that's a very, very, very good point to try to keep it as consistent as possible. I mean, I know I've seen some pictures from the 50s and early 60s where there was actually, the square was tarred. But I think cobblestones, if
Well, let me ask a question about the consistency. I mean,
and for full disclosure, I work for the city of Boston. I'm the director of operations at BTD. I just want to be clear, but this is also the neighborhood I'm born and raised in, and this I love North Square. And I can also tell you, Ford, that there will not be a bike rack in there, and there will absolutely not be. Because my guys installed the bike racks, that won't happen.
So, just looking at this option, we have the existing granite reset, then we have this new granite. Is it better to have consistency, whether it's new granite, as opposed to something that's broken up like that?
Now,
I think with time, it probably will weather, and you might not necessarily see the difference, but you will always be able to see it.
And you may have answered this, I was here 15 minutes late. Are we going to recycle the current cobblestones that are there?
Under this scenario, the darker cobble area, the gray area, here, that's reusing and resetting the existing cobble.
Which I think is great. I mean, but at the same time, you hear a lot about handicap accessibility. And that's why, you know, it's we have to give a little to get a little, and you know, the square should be accessible to everyone. And people have had a hard time navigating, especially seniors and older people, and people in wheelchairs have always been challenged in the square. It's very difficult. I mean, even I can time to time maybe take a Dixie in there. It's tough. The cobblestones are tough. Yeah. It's tough on the cars too. To be honest with you, it's tough to remove snow. It's tough to clean. But I mean, I guess if they're reset, and these are all things you never really think about. But you know, look at the winter that we had last year, and we'll probably never have one like that again, hopefully. But you know, it's hard to do snow removal in a place like that. And there are people coming to this neighborhood 12 months a year now. You know, you have tours 12 months a year. You know, people are always in Boston. But I don't necessarily oppose the. I mean, I guess I understand what Victor was saying too. It looks very sterile and very white. But I guess over time, it's probably going to break, just like a baseball
player. We can specify a granite that isn't that. I think Joe pointed out that we're trying to find a way to graphically differentiate between, I mean, this is what it looks like now. It's a little darker. You can actually start to see the joints in the cobble, those dark spaces that you see. So if you imagine those all close together, this would lighten up considerably. But we can specify a great granite that's a little bit more on the darker side, that doesn't have quite that sterile look that was being mentioned. So that's a relatively straightforward thing for us to do when we put the plans out of bid. So am I hearing that something like this is maybe better from a long-term standpoint as opposed to that, or?
Can I say?
Great,
okay.
Well,
why don't
we make a vote on one with the
before we vote on it, I still like, three, but where you have the walkways coming into the triangle, you can do on the sides of it either a brick on the inside, and that will contrast the two and diffuse that big white area.
I mentioned that before. I believe at the last meeting what I heard was any use of brick, we didn't have brick around the edges, that was really, I think it was almost unanimous that that was not a good idea.
Brick, you know what, brick, I mean, if you even up and down Hanover Street on the Freedom Trail, it's just, and this will be brand new, obviously, but it's just, it's such a pain in the butt to maintain. All over the city, all Public Works spends tons of resources on maintaining the brick sidewalks up in Beacon Hill and along Blackstone Street or North Street at the corner of Blackstone. They're always out there. It's just, it's such a pain. It's so tedious, and you know, our guys do the best they can, but they're not, you know, they're not professional masons either. You know what I mean? They do the best they can. But the bricks,
I'm talking in the triangle one.
What do you mean, like an edge, like kind of?
No. Wait, you see the four entrances on that. In between the four entrances, keep those white. Keep them granite, and then put the brick in those four cubicles.
Oh, all right, I got it. Yeah.
And it diffuses. It diffuses it. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think people can comment on it. Well, the reason why we don't have an option to have brick there was at the last meeting, one of the designs that we put out there wasn't really designed just something to get people thinking and talking, which I think it was successful at doing. That was not something that was looked on favorably.
A question about cobblestone. And the problem of rough sides and really trying to make rough sides to make the surface not rough. Can you set cobblestones in mortar?
Yeah.
And that would.
Well, what I'm trying to say is the sides that go against each other, because they're rough, you can't get them really tight.
Yeah.
And then when you look at the top of the surface that you walk on, ride on, they're rounded. So the combination of those two things, you're creating a space. And that's the space that I believe Sandra was talking about, and I would agree, that becomes an issue when it comes to maintenance and cleaning and keeping that, not being problematic.
Well, my question addressed that issue. Can it be mortared so that the mortar levels it up?
Well, yeah, the mortar like that would break up, and you're talking about having maybe a mortar joint of some thickness in between them. Then that becomes part of the visual character of the surface. And it's a weak point. It'll break up.
The surface of the cobblestone itself is irregular.
Is what?
It's irregular.
Yeah, so water.
Oh, I see. Well, should it be flattened?
Well, that's the accessibility.
I actually paid to try to have that done, and it's not feasible.
Work.
Yeah.
I don't think in the long term, I don't think it'll hold up. Because the rounded edge of the bricks when they come down, that'd be a place where water would also set. And I mean, water, freeze and thaw, it'd be problematic in the long term. Mm-hmm. I promised this one right here.
A point down the road of once all these other things aren't figured out. But are you contemplating just movable furniture in there? Like,
we haven't
there
really
picnic tables now, which serve the purpose and enjoy them, but I don't know if that's something that's, I mean, it seems
so
to be a secondary point.
Hearing comments is something that we're going to be considering as we move the design forward. So is there a desire to have, I've heard people say, maybe not picnic tables, but just benches and chairs or picnic tables?
I mean, clearly it needs some seating in there somehow.
I guess I'm going to ask my neighbors to consider that there's an opportunity to make the square accessible. I think in Randy's defense, what we're looking at is not a design thing where we can judge it in terms of is it sterile, what color is it this, is it that, but in terms of the broad strokes, the concept, the goals, the idea is to make the square accessible. We have an opportunity to make the entire space accessible. Veterans, the old people, the people that use the church, everybody can enjoy all of it. Do we really want to limit them to simple paths that constrain them to these areas and make the rest inaccessible? I teach interior design and architecture at two different universities. I have, as part of the class, I make the students walk around in a wheelchair, try to navigate in a wheelchair, to understand what it means to try to get around. And I really think if we have an opportunity to make this entire space accessible, we ought to think hard about the alternative to that. that. So that's why I argue for concept one, regardless of, you know, what we think of the planters or the benches or whatever, but the broad idea of making the place accessible to all, I think is a virtuous one.
So concept one is getting rid of the chains totally, right?
No.
What I think we're talking about right now is
that's
the, so this is, this dark gray is reset columns. What you'll see in concept one is this is all new brand material. Again, I would agree with the idea of this darkness aside, we can deal with that. But from an accessibility issue, we've already talked about how we may change the design that's shown on these three options with the chain. But from an accessibility standpoint, and I guess a maintenance standpoint too, having this all granite, new granite, as opposed to pieces like that. I'm going to go here and there.
I'll just offer a suggestion, maybe a compromise, but I mean, I think there could be a discussion on how much granite versus how much. You have a certain ratio there of little caps and a lot of cobblestone. And, you know, I recognize Sandra's point, although I don't think everyone believes that the primary goal here is making this whole thing accessible. Although that is a good goal, and I'm not going to say that it should be done. But I think that there are other goals, like making sure that it's consistent with the historical nature, as Steve said, making sure that it still works as it does right now, having the right kind of horticulture there. There are a lot of things that are competing here. So maybe we can talk about the ratios.
So under concept two, basically concept two just has the center portion as new granite. The roadways are reset cobble with just these zones and crosswalks where we need to have accessibility as the new granite as well.
I think some of us want to see some cobblestone in the square too. I mean, I'll speak for myself, but I think the reason that we've heard so many people say three is because there's a certain beauty of having the cobblestones in the middle. And, you know, I think there's a discussion that we had about how many cobblestones and how much granite pavers. You've already started that in concept three, there's a mix. Maybe we just need to get the ratio. That's the thing. There's one thing I want to add to that too, when it gets to sort of what there is being done in racial revere versus what you guys are doing. One of the things that we're sort of dancing around is how this space is going to be used. And some people are thinking, you know, they're going to be mainly tourists. Sandra was talking about the veterans and the older folks. We've heard about, potential concerts and all that. In a parks department study, you know, something like what they're going to do for the product, typically they talk about these uses and these activations right up front and really get and sort of nail it, like what everyone thinks this space is for. And one of the worries I have in this process, the reason that I suggested, you know, you guys link to the city as best you can, is because we're sort of shortcutting that. We're not really fully having that discussion about what this space is going to be used for. And I'm just a little
well, worried. I think one of the things I tried to make clear, maybe I didn't do a good job, is that what we're trying to do is accommodate the uses that it really is out there today. We're not trying to design a space for new uses. We're trying to design a space for the way it's being used today with the accessibility issues and the nod towards historic and the ability to account for circulation, be it pedestrian deliveries or vehicles. But we're not, unless I heard it wrong at the last meeting, I think it was clear then that we're not looking for this to become a bunch of new uses here.
And yes, that's true. But the one thing I'm saying is there have been murmurings, you know, in this meeting right now about different alternate uses. Why don't we do this? Why don't we do that? Vendors have been mentioned and all that. And we're just sort of not confronting. We're not actually addressing that.
I think the vendor issue came up and everybody was like, ooh.
But the concert issue came up and everyone didn't necessarily go, ooh. Although,
so I think
if there were four concerts a month.
So what we're doing with the design is trying to honor the space the way it's being used today, improve accessibility for the pedestrians. If those things were to take place and the desire of the community to allow those things to take place, then I don't think we're doing anything that would stop that. But really the focus of the design intent is to try to work with and really respect the uses as they are today.
I agree with Sandra that the accessibility about that space is the most important aspect of it, as far as I'm concerned, in concept one to do it. growing up in the North Bend, years and years and years ago, that square was utilized far more than it is today. The idea that there was always been something in the center of that space is just simply not true. There's nothing there. And to make the space more accessible, to make it more useful, would seem to be the way to go.
So I want to make sure we're clear, as the folks are going to be furthering the design. We have this particular option, which has the accessible areas and the visual differentiation and also the physical differentiation of the accessible places. And then we have this plan, which is all new with the reused granite in more of the roadway areas. We'll do it one more time after the debate. What do people think? I mean, do we think we want to have a more unified, cohesive area? Don't focus in on the planter in this one because that's up for maybe being tweaked. But just from the standpoint of having a cohesive material, granite to granite paper in the center, and just reusing the cobbles in the roadway. What do people think about that? Yes? No?
Well,
raise your hand if you're in favor of it.
Are you going to vote like two versus three? Are we going to do that right now?
Well, all we have is two and three right now. So, I mean, trying to get a general sense of where people fall, because it seems to be going back and forth a little bit. Do you prefer this one or that one?
Three.
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 Two? Okay, raise your hands. Three.
Three.
Two.
Which one?
Four.
What happened to one?
All right. All right, so I think we have maybe not the most clearest way of moving forward, but we have an idea of what we're all expecting. So we'll be able to come back and be able to discuss that. Other questions, comments?
I have a question about streetlights and trash cans. You're going to use the existing streetlights, I'm assuming.
We'll be coordinating with the folks in the city on that.
And the only thing I would say is that as the street gets narrower, panel trucks clip those lights. So you have to be, wherever they're positioned, they have to be positioned so that a panel truck going by, because working at the Revere House, we called the fire department, we had flames coming out of them. They're beautiful and we should keep them. But we need to position them so they're not constantly being hit by trucks.
Right.
That's all.
Yep.
And we have one big belly trash can.
What side do they get clipped?
The one that gets clipped is the one right there, and right at the point of the square. Right at that one, because the Hitchport House sits proud into the sidewalk.
Yep.
That's right, very narrow now. Yeah. So if a truck goes up, that one's been clipped. And the other one gets clipped is the one right in front of the rear house. Trucks like to back into that one. They don't need it. They do. So I'm just saying, in terms of where they're positioned and how those, they have a little piece that comes out of the sides, that's what gets clipped. So I'm just saying, when we're thinking about positioning,
yep,
at least think about that. There's one big belly on the Rachel Revere side, and that is on a busy holiday weekend. That is full within moments. Is there any talk about having something slightly larger, adding trash?
Those are only one size, but there are units that have a recycling component.
That might be.
Yeah, you should get they basically come in a pair, the regular trash and a recycling one.
I'm sure we can get another one in there.
Yeah.
What about no trucks?
What do they have to deliver to?
What about if they park on Hanover Street and they two-wheel
the
goods?
Well, some of them are actually construction.
I don't mean to change the subject, I'm just...
Yeah.
If we're going to make this look nice and pretty, we spend all kinds of money.
You said white stuff is a mess, as it is, it's a mess with the lawn, and you kind of get,
I want to make sure I can hear what people
say. I think the trucks and the streetlights can coexist if we are just thoughtful about where they are, that's all.
The parking in front of the church, that side of North Square,
That's totally illegal, correct? All that parking along the chain link?
Yes.
An idea would be to make the park a little wider on that side, so they won't be able to park there.
What happens when it's funerals?
It's wide enough, it's still wide enough.
We have, in funerals, we have, it's even by the church.
No, you would still be able to.
Yeah, but they park on both sides.
They move, they start the whole street, you can't even go up.
Kind of.
Other questions, comments? Our next steps are to take your input, coordinate with folks at Rachel Revere to come up with a preferred alternative, and I think at some point we'll have a meeting where we do a joint meeting between Rachel Revere and the North Square project and show how that the designs have come along. I'm not exactly sure when that will be, but stay tuned. I think that's the next step.